All right, I think we're going to go ahead and get started. I'd like to welcome everyone here today. My name is Representative Mike Dudgeon. I represent District 25 in the Georgia House, which is the southern part of Forsyth County and the northernest slice of Johns Creek in Fulton County. Before we get started, I'm on my best behavior today because one of the associate pastors from my church is here, who's also a constituent of mine, Reverend Brian Tillman. I'd like to have him come up and give us a short invocation.
Thank you, Mike. Let us pray. Awesome God, we give you thanks for this opportunity to share, to come together, to discuss differences, issues, and things of interest to all of us. We pray that your grace is with us. That everyone that stands up to speak and to share, it's mindful that you are present here with us in this place, and that we can keep a positive tone and atmosphere and leave this place being better citizens, better people, and better disciples, and better inhabitants of this area. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Brian. All right, we're going to try something today, and we'll see how well it works. More volume? More volume. Is that better?
Yeah.
All right. More volume. We're going to try something today. How many of you can read the big numbers on the screen? Raise your hand. All right, most people. So what this is a text poll, and I'm going to be using this to get some feedback from the room today. So the code to text to, like the phone number you're dialing, is 22333. So if you get out your phone and text 22 to the number 22333, like that's their phone number, and then you see the codes on the screen, and the question is, how did you learn about this town hall meeting? So if it's Facebook, the message you will send is 872-513, email 890-045, etc. And then, you're texting it to the number 22333. And that 22333 number will be the same the whole night. And as you see, as people do it, the results update automatically. So this is kind of an icebreaker question to kind of see if this works and how many people get to respond. And as we rolling up, I see numbers rolling in. That's pretty cool.
Hey, Mike, call out the top code.
Yeah, the top code, the number you are dialing, like it's your friend's phone number you're going to text, is 22333. So it's two twos and three threes. 22333. And while y'all are doing this, I'm going to give some ground rules and kind of tell you how we're going to work today, and then I'm going to give you my five-minute presentation, and then we're going to get started. One great thing about the Georgia legislature is we have very good rules of decorum and how we do business. And this is what we're going to talk about today is controversial. There's a lot of emotional opinions on both sides. So what I want today is, for the best of our ability, and Brian prayed for us this way, is that we keep calm and non-personal. When you're in the well of the Georgia House, you cannot call other people out by name, you cannot insult people, you stick to the issues and you stick to your position. Obviously there's some people in this subject who have opinions that things are not being done correctly here in the county or wherever, and that's fine to express those. What I'm asking is very much please that it's not personal and that we keep it to the issues and to the decisions that are made and to where we're going. The topic of this town hall, though we have at least one other speaker on another topic, is governance in Forsyth County. I've been a resident here since 2000. The population of this county is almost now 200,000 people. And I did some research and published an editorial about a month ago in the paper looking at, so how do other counties in Georgia govern themselves who are 150,000 or bigger? It turns out of those 14 counties that Forsyth County is the only one set up the way that we have it set up, which is with five commissioners, all elected by district, and then one small city. If you look at almost every other county of our size, there's multiple cities, or there's a city-county consolidated government, and almost every county commission has at least one county-wide elected person. So we're different. Different doesn't necessarily mean bad, but when you're different, it makes you wonder, are we doing the right thing? And of course, we're different too, because Forsyth County has changed enormously in the past 30 years. So I'm an engineer and a technology entrepreneur by trade, when not in the legislature. And I'm trained to think it's important what we've done in the past, but what do we need to do to make things work in the future? In the technology business, if you don't change, then a lot of times you get left behind. So what is the right governance model for Forsyth County moving forward with a 200,000 person county and still growing and growing. That's the subject I'm interested in. I've done enough research, I've talked to many people in this room, and I believe it's important that we start talking about this in a public manner. I'm a firm believer that sometimes you have to take controversial things out from the back room and into the front room. And that's why I wanted to have this town hall meeting today. But I'm counting on everybody here to keep, again, the discussion civil, polite, non-personal, stuck to the issues. Now, a lot of you who know me know that I'm a 25-year Georgia high school sports official, did basketball for 20 years and have done football for a couple of years now. I brought my penalty flag. I don't want to have to throw it on anybody, but I did bring it. But what we're going to do, here's the format. There's a few people who are what I would call subject matter experts on some of these topics, and I've selected them to have a little bit of extra time at the beginning. Carter, will you go over and get the sign-up sheet so we can count the number of people? We'll figure out how many minutes people get. Carter's going to keep the time. He's going to have a couple forms, pieces of paper, hold up, say you've got 1 minute left or you have your time's up. We're also going to say in order who's speaking so that when you're on deck, if you were to come up and sit up here so that you'll be ready so we don't have people wandering through the room waiting for the next speaker to show up. So we have 13 people. And we have 7:10. I really want to get done at 8:30. I don't want to be here all night. The first few people have like 5 minutes and then probably four for the next group because I want to save some time, the last 20 minutes if I can, to moderate a discussion. Oh, that seems like might be hard in a big room like this. But I want to have time for people to ask short questions and some of these experts to give an answer because it's good to have a format where everybody's just talking, but a lot of times a give or take works. I've done this format across the state with on the issue of Common Core, which we're not going to talk about today, but I ran this format all across the state for the education committee and it worked actually pretty well. So without further ado, we're going to get into our speakers. So the first two speakers are Stephen Newman and Jim Warner. So Stephen, if you would come on up, and then Jim, if you could be ready up here so when Stephen is done. And when you come up, please just introduce yourself. If you're with a particular group, say that and sort of where you live and just give us just real basics and then we'll get going. Stephen.
Thank you very much. Yes, my name is Stephen Newman. I am one of the founders of the Sharon Springs Alliance. I'd also like to introduce Eric Crump, who's here with us as well. He's also one of the founders. All right. So the Sharon Springs Alliance is a nonprofit group filled with local residents who are exploring whether or not cityhood would be both feasible and viable for the area of South Forsyth. It's made up of volunteers. We all have families here. We are all full-time work. We have full-time jobs. Frankly, our lives are all hectic, just like yours. We're all citizens that have lived all over North Georgia, but we've chosen here to make it home. We came here because Forsyth County has some amazing benefits, some amazing reasons why we're all here. We love our schools. We love our parks, our green space, our neighborhoods. We love our way of life. However, as we've lived amongst other counties, we've also seen other counties struggle with rampant growth, right? We've watched our quality of life degrade in other areas due to missteps by those counties and how they handled that growth. We've all actually personally witnessed here the rampant growth in Forsyth County. Carter, is it possible I can get those slides up? The rampant growth that we've seen is witnessed by the increased traffic, the clear cutting of trees to create even more new neighborhoods, the frustrating orange and yellow signs. And what's really pertinent in where we're sitting right now is the overcrowding of schools, if you can. So I wanna just show you something here. Last year, if you took a look at all, and this is on the public Forsyth County Board of Education website, if you took a look last year, 16 of our 37 schools are overpopulated. Now, despite the fact that we just voted in and agreed to a $195 million bond for schools, when that goes into place, right, and we've expanded the schools, we've made this school even bigger, we've added more schools, all set to be done by 2018, the forecast is that we'll have 18 schools that are overcrowded. So even with that extra money, all that pouring into our community, we're still going to be in an overcrowded state. In fact, a worst case, if you can move forward. Now, Mike was talking about the population, and I realize it's a little difficult to see here, but this is the population of Forsyth County every decade since it started in 1840. All the way up to 2010, which had us roughly at about 175,000 people. Now, if you look at the rate of change being 123%, 78%, if you take even a smaller rate of change, right, at 70%, by the year 2020, we're gonna be closing in on 300,000 residents in this county. So really what we're sitting here asking the question tonight is, do you think Forsyth County is ready for that change? Now, the Sharon Springs Alliance, our whole focus is exploring if cityhood is the solution to help us deal with those changes. Now, our main focus is to commission a study, a feasibility study commissioned by an independent third-party organization. In this case, it's the Carl Vinson Institute of the University of Georgia. And what they're gonna focus on is how do we bring the information and data forward so we understand what it might mean to be a city. Now, the structure of that study doesn't come in an arbitrary fashion, right? The Carl Vinson Institute is looking to the Sharon Springs Alliance to provide them with the information, such as which services they're gonna do the research on and what are the boundaries of that study, right? The boundary of the city for the study. They are also expecting us to be able to fund that study, right? So that's a big focus of what we have to do. We have to raise those funds to bring that study forward. Now, the Sharon Springs Alliance has put in countless hours doing our homework to really understand what the complex process is of getting access to that data. Frankly, we believe this feasibility study is critical. We have to do this kind of study to understand all of the options that are on the table, right? To understand what does it mean for this area to grow into that population? What are those services cost? What are the things that we need to know to make an informed decision? Now, when people first hear the notion of a city, there's always two questions, right? The first question is, will my taxes go up? The second question is, will it create additional layers of government? Well, I'll address the first question first. Of the 9 cities that have been created in the state of Georgia in the last decade, none of the residents in those cities are paying more property taxes today than they were before they became a city. This would suggest that if there was a city in the southern part of Forsyth County that doesn't necessarily need to have any increased taxes. Now, the key is to run a feasibility study. The feasibility study will look at the services we're trying to offer, understand the cost structure to those, and be able to give us that information so that we can financially understand what does it mean to be a city and what would it take. Now, the second thing is an additional layers of government. Now, the structure that we would ask the Carl Vinson Institute to explore is one in which they would address certain services that would be brought locally, right? Those services probably would be planning, zoning, code enforcement, while the other services remain at the county level, things like parks, recreation, fire, police, right? The key here is that there's no duplication of services for any of the residents, right? We're not talking about adding additional layers of government. We're just bringing some of those closer to here to deal with those changes, deal with those population growth, and leave the other services with the county where folks believe and feel that those services are being well done. Now, to restate the mission. The mission of the Sharon Springs Alliance is to gather your input, what the challenges you feel are, and to generate data, right? A big part of this process is commissioning that study. Now, with a study, it will give us an unbiased information, right? Unbiased information necessary to make those informed decisions on cityhood and whether it's viable and feasible. As such, we suggest those that claim that we haven't presented that data would probably be and should be the first one in lines to donate. Now, to quote one of our commissioners, Forsyth County is the jewel of Georgia. At Sharon Springs Alliance, we believe in this and we believe it's worth fighting to keep it that way. That's why we're here tonight, to work together and to find solutions to make Forsyth a great place to live. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you. So next is Jim, and Jim has taken some public positions in a different tone, and because Steve got a little bit extra time, we'll let Jim have the extra time if he wants it. And after Jim is Tony DeMaria.
Thank you. I've been a resident here in Forsyth County for about 14 years now. I live in Long Lake. Long Lake is right smack in the middle of the area that you're talking about, we're talking about. When this first came out in January is when I saw it. There was an article published in one of the newspapers. I looked at it and I said, I don't need that. There's no reason for me to have what I think is going to be additional government. Say what you want. You're going to have politicians laid in there, and it's not going to be for free. It's going to cost money. And when I saw that, I said, no, that's not for me. Since then, I wrote another piece that was in the, were in the Forsyth County News, which kind of responded to the piece that Mike had written earlier. And so that's basically where I stand now. Now, what I've been asked to do is to address the cons of the situation here. If you were to go back and read the articles that I've written, you would find that I am not opposed at all to looking at the county to see where improvements can be made. But I'm pretty sure the city is not the best way to go. And so with that, I'll go ahead and I'll be talking about the cons. First, I've got, I need to make one other comment. I need to make it very clear that what I'm saying are my own opinions. I've done my own research. I'm not working with anybody, and I'm not working for anybody. And so you can take it for what it's worth. I'm saying this for the people that are sitting here, not for myself. I'm not going anywhere with this. First topic is concerns with the unsubstantiated new city proposal. It's based on some generic and anecdotal items. Now, you saw some statistics there. I would say I'd have to understand those statistics to decide whether I wanted to believe them. The things that have been lamented are the county government, planning and development, traffic conditions, schools, and there's been stories about lamenting about addresses in the southern part of the county, and a community identity. There hasn't been any discussion to provide any evidence that I've seen that says a new city would ensure more effective government, and as has been already described, how much it would cost. We're waiting on a feasibility study. Second topic is the community. In my mind, the community in this area here is Forsyth County. There's a lot of developments in this county, and each one of those is a contributor to that overall picture. I could call that a community entity, if you will. So I'm not really hot on the idea of having a new identity put on top of the place where I live. It's the county is well known. It's got low taxes, got top ratings with Moody's and Standard & Poor's, and I'm not sure how much better it's going to get. And can it grow? Yes. Does it change? Yes. The county does change. It also has a professionally managed government. We have a county manager and we have some permanent staff that provide that kind of management for the county. So it's not just the commissioners that are sitting out there trying to run the show. I've read some articles that say that doesn't work very well. Sharon Springs, on the other hand, is an area about a mile and a quarter long that connects Old Atlanta with Peachtree Parkway. There's three developments in there. They're all older developments. That's where Sharon Park Springs is. That's where the senior center is. And that's it. It has no recognition, no name, no nothing. One of the things that I have been a little upset about is what I call dissing Forsyth County. If you're going to find fault, I guess then you have to decide you're going to have some fault found. And I'm going to read a little bit of this because I didn't make this up. We don't have any direct say. I don't think I agree with that. We have very little local representation. I'm not sure what that means. All five commissioners vote on all policies, zoning applications, development decisions. I think that's the way the system is set up. Decisions about local issues and I'm not sure how much more local you can get in Forsyth County, are often made by commissioners with little or no accountability to the local electorate. Incoming, the Sawney mailing addresses aren't really accurate. Okay, I'm being told I got one more minute. I guess I'm going to talk about the zip code gripe. There are four zip codes that are affected in this map, which is the only one I got. It's like that bigger one back there. 30041, 30024, 30097, which is basically St. Marlowe, and 30005, which are some that come up from the bottom. There's not going to be a new post office. The best the post office will do is let you add another city name under other acceptable cities. And three of those zip codes, except for 0041, already have Johns Creek as an other acceptable city. So that's the kind of level of community identity you're going to have. I guess we talked enough about taxes. Planning and development. The problem with planning and development is there's more to it than just planning and development. There's a whole raft of people who work to verify that the things that are in an application for zoning are in fact aligned with the regulations and meet the criteria. So there's a big staff under there. And that staff is going to have to come from somewhere. If you set up a new city, the staff is either going to be from the county, that could be arranged, intergovernmental agreement, or it's going to be contracted out. It's going to cost money. I can't believe it's not going to cost money. So my time is up. I got a couple of other things. I have a handout if anybody's interested in getting more detail, and I'll be right now.
Thank you, Jim. Really appreciate it. And again, I hate to be a stickler on time, but if we're not, then it is hard to keep the meeting going. Tony DeMaria is next, and then Brant Meadows is after that. Tony.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Tony DeMaria, Forsyth Citizens for Responsible Growth. I've been here since 2002, and I think it's great. I love it. I think the people are great. I think we got a lot of good things going for us, and yet we can't just sit and do nothing. I think we need improvements. I'm going to talk about 3 points, and then if I have time, a little bit about the city. But 3 points. One is our governmental structure. Right now, my judgment and a lot of other people is that it needs improvement. In 2009, all of a sudden, I lost 80% of my voting power. Before that, I could vote for 5 commissioners. In 2010, I could only vote for 1. And guess what? All 5 commissioners still could vote for all districts. That didn't quite seem fair or reasonable. So we need to look at that and see what could we do better. Now, also take a single district commissioner. A single district commissioner, has he lost or she lost power? I think the answer is yes, because when they want to do something that their district wants them to, if, as it happens often, 3 other commissioners from outside their district say, no, we don't want it because we have different loyalties. We don't really understand what you want to do. And it's really not in our interest. That commissioner lost his power, and that happens today. So there's 2 questions on the structure that I'd like you to think about. Do you really feel that today our representation is fair and reasonable? All right. Secondly, and this one takes a little more thinking. If a young couple, one of them just out of the service, came to Forsyth and was looking to start up here, and then you told them, well, look, we know you fought in the war, we know you did good for us, but right now, moving forward, you can only vote for 20% of the elected officials in this county. What would that young man or that young lady say? That's our problem today. So think about those two questions. Thank you. Our officials need to be more responsive to the homeowner. Simply put, homeowners are 90% of this population. And they worry about it, they work at it, as they should, okay? But it's obvious to a lot of people that the old time power structure that's been there forever, probably before the mayor, still controls, I got 1 minute remaining, still controls much of the county. And that exists. I won't get into rapid growth, high density, all that, because you all know it's there. Two other points. We need greater confidence and trust in our officials. Right now, a lot of us just don't have a lot of confidence that they're making the right decision or that we can really trust them. So we need that, and we need to work with them or to work with new ones, but we need to develop a better sense of belonging and working together. Three points about the city. And I'm not an advocate, but I think they've done a great job, and I think they're doing the right thing with their investigation. First, don't be guided by the city of Tillman. The city of Tillman is a relic of the past, and it's a relic of the old culture, which we want to do away with. Living in, somebody used 300,000, living in a 60,000 population city, to me, could be a lot better than living in a 300,000 county population. And if I had both of them together, I really could have something. So don't say no, don't say yes, but read what SSA has to say, because they have some good points. It'll take a while to figure it out. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tony. Brant. After Brant is Kyle Bevis.
Thank you, State Representative Mike Dudgeon, and thanks for having us out. I just counted. We have over 200 people here this evening. That is fantastic. If it wasn't for Mike Dudgeon, if it wasn't for the City of Cumming, if it wasn't for the Sharon Springs Alliance, we probably wouldn't be here this evening. And that's where I lead to, I rise to speak about consolidation of the City of Cumming and Forsyth County. The current governance system leads a lot of us feeling like we're in a war, district warfare. Oftentimes a war between the city of Cumming and Forsyth County. Many of us feel like that it's taxation without representation. I feel that. Without going into great detail, you have to look at a little bit of the background of the city of Cumming and where did they get the money, because you always have to follow the money. And in following the money, you realize that the city of Cumming, when they got their first local option sales tax split in the early 1990s, received almost three times their previous year's entire budget. Follow the money. So you go through a couple of decades of taking money on local option and special local option sales tax from you, and they collect that money. That's a problem. And I'm looking for a level playing field between the city of Cumming and Forsyth County. In doing consolidation, you look at some of the benefits that would exist. It's been said that there would be over a 25% reduction in your taxes if we consolidate the city of Cumming and Forsyth County. We eliminate a level of administration. We eliminate human resources. We consolidate the water department and the water and sewer department so that everybody in the county and the city, we all pay the same rate for water. You don't pay more, you don't pay less. So following the money again, if you look at the benefits, you realize that you can eliminate a layer of government, and that's what I'm in favor of. Again, I'm thankful for the Sharon Springs Alliance for allowing us to come out this evening and to be able to voice our concerns. Without the Sharon Springs Alliance, without Mike Dudgeon, without the scoundrels at the city of Cumming, we would not be here this evening. So I would ask for you guys to please consider supporting a consolidation of city and county. Thank you very much. Hey, I love the city of Cumming. I despise their government. Clear that up. Thank you.
first flag of the evening on my friend Brant. Next is Kyle, and after that is Stephanie Raymond.
Hey everybody. First, let me just say I'm Kyle Bevis. I'm a resident here. I've been here about 13 years. Okay, sorry. Better. Hey, first let me say thanks everybody for coming tonight. It's nice to see that so many residents care so much about our county as we do. This is the beauty of Forsyth. You know, you could have a county as large as Fulton County, and you wouldn't even have half this many show up. But it's great that we have so many people here who care. And the great thing is that we all care about the same thing. We're looking forward to 5, 10, even 20 years in the future for ourselves and our children of what we want to have. Now, how I'm speaking on this, I'm kind of a little redundant because I'm speaking, I don't think we need a city. I mean, I think our first thing is we gotta look at is we don't need any new taxes. You know, we saw the board and everything of where, we'll be at the same, taxes or even less. But one thing it didn't show is fees. Electricity, your natural gas, your cable, your garbage, everything will have a fee on it. And so there will be taxes that you don't see, that you will be paying. But, for our real problem, I think, with the starting of the city and everything is voice. You know, do we have a voice in the county government? I think that's been one of the biggest issues. So let's say if the city did form and you have five council members, now what would you do? You'd have to go to five separate people. Where currently now all you have to do is just go to one commissioner. So if that commissioner is failing you, and your goal should be to go to that commissioner. If he fails you, then we get a new commissioner in. Shouldn't be to stack another level of government above that. So another thing is the city of Cumming. Basically, I'm a little redundant on what the other gentleman just said. We have enough issues with city, the water issues and everything else. Now, my goal is, and I think all of ours should be, is to merge the city of Cumming with the county, because that would be a great thing, because if we did that, we could reduce a lot of our taxes. But you think, hey, has this ever been done before and been successful? Well, you look at Columbus, Georgia, they've done it. You look at Athens, Georgia, they've done it. And recently, Macon, Georgia has done this. And they've reduced a lot of their cost. It's a lot better county to live in now. And so if we add another city, it's gonna be hard to get rid of that city. Then if you add another one, there's gonna be another one, and another one. So we keep adding it. Now, a way to even fix our commission is we have basically, we form a district, that we currently have. Because when we go to the voting polls right now, we're voting for one commissioner. Now, what if we could vote for one commissioner, a vice chairman, and a chairman? So we actually have three votes when we go to the commission. Now, that'd be something we could all create, and we'd have more voice in the commission. And so, let's see, I think I touched on everything I wanted to, but appreciate everybody letting me talk tonight, and I'll let it go. And thank you, and let me also say, Mike, thank you for everything you do in the House. You're basically getting paid at a part-time job, but we know it's not a part-time job you're doing. So thank you for what you do.
Thank you. All right, I'm glad to do this early because she wasn't in the room, but I want everyone to turn around and thank my lovely wife, Lori, for helping me get ready back here and being Vanna White and escorting people in, so. All righty. So at this time, Stephanie Raymond is next, and after that is Martin Chapman. Stephanie?
Thank you. I was hoping with this fancy poll system tonight that there was going to be a teleprompter available. But see, since I see that's not the case, I'll go ahead and get started. Just don't share my notes here. My name is Stephanie Raymond. I live here in the community. I live in the Creekstone Estates neighborhood, and I'm the chair of the zoning committee for the neighborhood. And I love Forsyth County. But I want to tell you a little bit more about myself because I bet we have a lot more in common than just living here in Forsyth County. I have children, two of them, they're in preschool. In 2011, like many people I've met, my husband and I considered moving to Milton and not staying in Forsyth County. We stayed because of the low taxes, because of the rural character, because it has great public schools. And I think that's the reason so many of you are here that have families or maybe grandchildren. I'm also not from here, like many of you. I've lived and worked throughout the US and traveled abroad fairly extensively. If, like me, you've seen other models for government and other models of development than what we are seeing here, you may feel like I do. We could be doing better for our children and for our future of the community. Every day I hear concerns from parents like myself. The schools are becoming overcrowded. Teachers are stretched too thin between the excessive class sizes and adjusting to new curriculum. Commutes have doubled in the last year for some of my neighbors, and it can take 3 to 4 lights at rush hour to go through local intersections. To me, these are manifestations of an underlying problem, which are zoning approvals. Too many homes are being built too quickly without the infrastructure to support the growth. Much of this construction The interesting part is much of this construction was approved between 2005 and 2008. So all the homes at the end of Ronald Reagan that are suddenly being built, those were approved years ago. They've been lying dormant through the economic downturn. Add to this fact that I don't think that we have taken those lying dormant into account as we've been approving new communities. And there's a lack of balance. And you have to forgive me for my numbers because I'm not sure they're accurate, but this year, my understanding is new homes that have been approved or requested, there are about 3,600 that are in the Res 3 category or higher, 3, 4, etc. That means 10,000 square foot lots or smaller. At the same time, Res 2 or above, 128 lots. Our actions indicate we don't understand the value of our community. How can we change this trajectory of unplanned growth? The great news is there are multiple homeowner groups working on solutions. In my opinion, 4 options exist. Continue fighting individual zonings, elect new commissioners in future election cycles, return to countywide voting, or pursue the Sharon Springs Alliance investigation of a new city. These are not exclusive. Real change is going to take multiple options. First and foremost, I support the investigation of a new city. It's tiring to fight individual zonings. It takes lots of homeowners and money that frankly we all don't have to put towards it. In many ways, our Board of Commissioners are hamstrung by precedents. They have made decisions in the past that are difficult to change now. It's far easier to wipe the slate clean with new zoning rules, more locally focused decision makers, and a well-defined plan for growth and development. I'll tell you, your taxes are gonna go up whether there's a new city or not. We've got a school bond, we have a transportation bond, there will be more. The data points out that it's not going to be enough. And we have very little identity, in my opinion. This is the time to establish a long-term plan for commercial and residential development. But my final point is the biggest reason I support the Sharon Springs Alliance efforts are the individuals I've met. They met with our neighborhood. They have put in an inordinate amount of time and research, meeting with surrounding neighborhoods and cities and towns, learning from them. They're like me, they're parents. They have children at all levels in the schools and they work in a variety of industries. They have also worked and lived a lot of places before deciding to call Forsyth County home. Please meet them. Get your own feel for their motivations and ask them the hard questions and have an open discussion about cityhood. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. Next is Martin Chapman, and after that is Kristen Stevens.
Thank you, Mike. I'd just like to say thank you to Mike for setting this up and for everybody for attending. As you guess, I'm not from around these parts. Across the pond, but most people think I'm Australian. When I first moved to the US, it was in 2005, and we moved into North Horn County from London. And we started looking around where we wanted to live. And we looked at North Horn, we really liked it. And then our realtor said, go up and look a little further north. Have a look around Forsyth. We think you'll really love what is up there. So we moved in 2006 into South Forsyth in Caney Creek subdivision, right where now Brookwood Elementary is now. I think that was meant to be phase five of our subdivision. We moved there because we loved all the amenities of North Fulton, Alpharetta, what is now Johns Creek. We loved the fact that we could get a bit more bang for our buck on the house. And we loved the fact that the taxis were good. Plus, everyone that we met in the area was similar to us. A lot of people who live in our area are from other countries or from other parts of the US, very cosmopolitan. We also loved the access to the North Georgia Mountains and to the outdoor areas of the lake and things like this, the same reason a lot of people moved here. The schooling that my children have had, and my eldest one is in seventh grade, and my youngest one is in sixth grade, has been first class. I cannot fault the teachers, the schools that they have attended. It's been fantastic, and I thank everyone who's been involved in that, some who are here tonight. My concerns is going forward, not from looking back. 2 years ago, we started to see more houses come on smaller lots. We started to see just a more congestion in the area. The schools started to get overcrowded. Considering Lambert's only been open since 2009, I found this kind of interesting that this was happening so quickly. My kids are due to go here in 2 years' time, or my eldest one, and I think this school was originally designed for 2,100 kids. I think with the new development, it'll be something like 2,700. And there's going to be probably close to 3,500. I'm basing that on what I've been told from people in the area and not on any hard fact, but seeing what the Sharon Springs guys put up here tonight, I can only say that it looks like it's correct. So my problems with what we have going on is that we have such congestion, overcrowding in schools, our roads are getting more congested, and there doesn't seem to be people who are listening to what's going on. You know, we've had situations where land zoned as one thing has been changed, subsequently changed again. You know, we need the tax dollars coming in. The revenue has to come from somewhere. It's not coming from all the homeowners. People are moving here because their children are at school. They love the fact that the taxes are cheap and the schooling is so fantastic. Now, that's not enough to cover everything that's going on. We need to have managed growth. We need to work out where we're going to put our schools. We need to get a plan in place before this happens. That I do not see that at this point, and I don't feel as if anyone is moving forward to the point where this is going to happen. So for me, I'm not saying that the city of Sharon Springs is the absolute be-all and end-all of what should happen, but it's something that should be considered along with the other options that are out there. Because at the end of the day, we want this county, and especially this, I didn't move to North Forsyth, I moved to South Forsyth for a reason. We want this part of the county to maintain its appeal. It's what keeps our house prices up, and it's why people want to move here and why we're the envy of most people around Atlanta. So for that, I just say, let's consider all the options. Let's listen to Mike. I think we need to, you know, no change and just saying, if it's not broke, don't try and fix it. It's not an option. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Martin. So Kristen Stevens is next, and Tony Martinez is on deck. Miss Kristen.
Okay. My name's Kristen Stevens, and I am one of the founding members of Forsyth HOA and Homeowners. If you haven't heard of us, check out our website, ForsythHOA.org. I did bring some presentation materials tonight, but I didn't realize that they were set up different than the Board of Commissioners, and I actually had to have a digital file. So I'll try to get that stuff online tomorrow too, if anyone wants to take a look at it. Basically, Forsyth HOA and Homeowners started last year because we saw one single zoning across the street from the most overcrowded high school in the county, and we were concerned about the lot sizes, the density that they were requesting. And so we had 8 members, and now we have thousands just over a year later. It didn't take us long to realize that our little zoning that we were concerned about was just the tip of the iceberg, and there was going to be a huge avalanche of growth coming in. And as Stephanie said earlier, we don't feel that there is adequate infrastructure. And in addition to that, we feel that the lot sizes are much, much smaller than the developments that had come in prior. Thanks, Scott, for the background music. So these houses are being packed in like sardines. It's not like the type of growth that we saw before. We've seen growth before. We've seen a lot of houses come in before, but they weren't all sitting on top of each other. And personally, I don't think it's great for the infrastructure. I don't think it's great for the roads. I don't think it's great for the schools. And I really don't think it's that great for the health of our community in general, especially since we don't really have adequate impact fees to cover this growth. So every time a new housing unit comes in and the impact fees aren't adequate, we get hit with bond and bond and bond again to try to catch up. So, one of the things that I wanted to say is that, when there was a lull in development and none of us were paying attention to what was going on, a lot of things were actually going on. One of the things is that the land use map was changed and approved. Another thing was that our unified development code was changed. And some of the changes were not very taxpayer friendly. One was to reduce the Res 3 lot sizes. One was to take the houses from 20 feet apart to 15 feet apart, reducing side yard setbacks. And also, what we noticed in 2013 is that our Board of Commissioners were approving a lot of zonings that did not comply with the land use map. And also, they were handing out variances pretty much like Halloween candy. And we've seen a slowdown in that, and we're really happy to see that change, but we just don't feel like it's enough. I really wanted to talk to you about that and our feelings about that first, because we in this area sometimes feel like we're not being heard and not being represented. And I feel like there's a very big reason as to how we got put in this position. And that has to do with the voting model for how we vote for our commissioners. Back in 2008, before 2008, we were able to vote for every single commissioner. There's five, and they can vote on anything that affects us in our own backyards. But there was a Forsyth County straw poll that was put on the primary election ballot in 2008. And in my opinion, and many other people's opinions, the wording on that straw poll was deliberately designed to mislead the general public. I can't put it up, so I will read it to you. Basically, it says, question number two, should the county character or charter be revised to provide county commissioners and school board members be elected by the voters in the representatives' districts, yes or no? Well, to a lot of people, they'd say, well, that sounds good, check, and there you go. My glasses would help, so I'm not squinting. Anyway, I don't think that most people were aware at that point that they were giving up their right to vote for all five county commissioners. Their votes greatly affect us, our kids' education, our taxes, our property values, our quality of life in general. So I feel like if we're happy with our commissioners' representation, we should be able to reward them with our votes, and if we're not, we should be able to vote them out, all of them, not just one who is in our district. I just wanted to say, I don't really think that our voting power should have been reduced from 100% to 20%. I think that a lot of the people around here are feeling very disenfranchised. We can't control what's going on in our own backyards anymore. And that's quite frankly why the city of Sharon Springs is investigating a city, is because we've lost our control over what goes on in our own community. Thank you.
Thank you, Kristen. Next is Tony Martinez, followed by Jack Gleason. Tony.
Thank you. Your Spanish is excellent. It's Martinez, not Martinez. Thank you. I appreciate this opportunity as I am a 17-year resident of this part of Forsyth County, and I too deplore how it's changed. Good evening. Again, I am Tony Martinez. Don't let the name throw you, folks. Born in El Paso, graduated from Texas A&M. I'm a Korean War veteran, and also a veteran. And also a veteran of 35 years of working for Coca-Cola's global marketing operations here and overseas. I should preface this, that my comments are probably going to be highly subjective. In fact, my wife of 52 years has told me that I'm crazy for talking like this. But what I have to say fairly well represents the comments of a lot of people in Three Chimneys Farm, and particularly the empty nesters of whom we are fairly organized. I don't agree with the creation of Sharon Springs. Briefly and more significantly, I don't see the need for overlapping and redundant jurisdictions. On the two occasions I've had to rely on sheriff services, once when a bunch of rednecks were target shooting in back of my house, and the second time when ATVs were trashing the Three Chimneys Farm nature trail, reaction was fast and efficient and excellent follow-up. Will I get that from Sharon Springs police? Second, I fear the onslaught of more taxes to pay for the Sharon Springs infrastructure, municipal building, bureaucratic staffing, police and related services. I have yet to hear what this is going to cost. In my opinion, it's probably about $1.5 million or more. Who's going to pay for all that? There's a lot of talk of being ignored in this part of the county by our commissioners. And I guess it's something we deserve. We voted them in. We've let the good old boys ruin our lives. I should say ruin our lives. For example, how many of you attend open meetings or keep after your representatives by phone calls, letters? Recently, we had the opportunity to vote in John DeRucci, a resident of South Forsyth County, but we stayed with the incumbent. As for schools, I fully appreciate this county's top-ranked schools, and I too have a dog in this fight. I have three grandchildren who attend local schools. I also volunteer with history presentations at Vickery, where I hear the teachers talking about overcrowding and how the kids hate the trailers. I personally don't pay the school tax, but believe me, I've paid quite a bit over the years. The consensus of my fellow empty nesters is against the move to incorporate. We don't need more taxes. Like them, I live on a fixed income. I no longer get annual income increases, and my stock portfolio is, I haven't even looked at it for the last couple of days. My wife says, why look at it? All you sit there, sit there and yell at the computer. As for tax revenue streams, I have talked to commissioners about publicizing Forsyth County to attract industry, not factories, smoke belching factories, but say dot-coms or regional offices. Deaf ears. Again, I ask, who's going to pay for all this? If anybody has any questions of me, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Tony. Great to hear from people like Tony who are citizens who are just giving their heartfelt opinion like that. I really appreciate that. Jack, and then after Jack is Matt Broms. Jack? He's going to do the...
I can move around. Greetings, everybody. My name is Jack Gleason. I've been a resident of Forsyth County since June of 2002. I moved here from Northern California. I was looking for a wonderful place for my family to raise, and I found it here. When we came, we put 900 miles on a realtor's car in 4 days just to find a place in South Forsyth County with an Alpharetta address, because we knew the taxes were low, we knew the schools were excellent, and we knew the quality of life was awesome. You can turn this down a little bit, I have a big voice. That said, being the activist that I was, I spent the first 2 years just kind of digging where I was at back in the end of my cul-de-sac there, but I started noticing traffic building and some other things. Actually, I had 4-pound Georgia black bass in my creek, and with the building development that went down, and I didn't get notified, and so I couldn't argue how things became, and the creek wound up dead. So I got involved. I started a Friends of Caney Creek. It's an adopt-a-stream, adopt-a-road organization, and I decided to be the change that I wanted to see. When I first came and looked around here, it was a nice, clean community, had beautiful rural charm and character, and that was fast becoming was. In 2008, I noticed the bond issue, the school bond and the transportation bond, and I thought, you know, we need some parks and green space around here. And I noticed the headwaters of my creek, which was the Harrison property at the time, and they had little green flags all the way around it, vote yes for the $100 million green space bond. And I thought, wow, you know, our roads are kind of cruddy, and McGinnis Ferry is pretty jacked up all the time, and Brookwood, et cetera, and those were on the list. But when I got to read the fine print about how they prioritized it, I realized what's been happening in Forsyth County is these areas of congestion, I'll call it coagulation of our arterials, if you will, remain in perpetuity, okay? And it seems like it's used as bait because there's this problem that they seem to control to get us to approve these bonds in succession, because it was on SPLOS 3, those same issues, and when I first moved here, but I couldn't vote yet. And yet, you know, those problems hadn't been resolved. What happens is the lion's share of that money gets taken, and it was being thrown towards larger roadways like Ronald Reagan Parkway or Marketplace Boulevard or Freedom Parkway, and they took tens of millions of dollars, and then there was no money left over to fix the roads and add turn lanes and add or that such stuff. Okay, so I joined Smart Growth for Forsyth. That was the only organization at the time that was active as their environmental compliance officer and dealt with water issues and such. And we spent the next few years arguing with the county and everything like that. And then the recession came in, and all of a sudden the growth slowed down. The county did wind up buying some green space for the south part of the county. Originally it wasn't proposed on the green space bond. I actually was against the green space bond and the transportation bond after I looked at the fine print. And that's where we really need to look at how our expenditures have been prioritized. We have these problems, and they get sold to us, but then the money seems to go elsewhere and the problems remain. Further of that, I do want to take a moment and say that I don't really believe we need another city. I don't think we need another level of government. I embrace the concept of less government is more. However, I would, because of things going on and the interest in it, I do believe we should have the study to determine the feasibility of a Sharon Springs Alliance. I like Brant's concept, except that I don't really have that much of a bash for the city government. Actually, I think they're very smart. They functioned very, very well over the last 44 or 50 years to the success that they're, if you look at them objectively, they've done some very, very smart things. They're very, very healthy. And so, and we have a very unique opportunity here in Forsyth County that we only have one city to deal with. And that's why I would embrace the merge of the city and the county. You may or may not know, I'm water issues. I'm also a citizen advisor on the board advisory council for the Upper Chattahoochee for the Metropolitan North Georgia Water Planning District. So I'm privy to some discussions. Turn this down, please. So I'm privy to some discussions about our water supply, and that should be a really serious concern to people here. Our quality of lives is based on, fundamentally, is the quality of the air. Second to that is water, okay? And right now, we don't have a water, the Army Corps of Engineers hasn't determined exactly what our water allocation is. And the trajectory, the growth trajectory projected for this county is anywhere from 340 to 680,000 people over the next 20 or 30 years. Our strongest stance in terms of garnering a water allocation is the unification of Forsyth County and the city of Cumming. So thank you.
Doesn't like being that high up in there. So next is Matt Broms. and then Bob Rorke after that. By the way, we got our next poll question up while we're getting Matt up here. The same number you text to 22333. The question, if you can't read it, is do you think we should have change in some way how Forsyth County is governed? Actually, we misspelled it there. We have a typo. We're in a school, and we did it badly. Do we think we should change in some way how Forsyth County is governed? Text to 22333, and the answers are yes, maybe, and no. All right, Matt.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Matthew Broms. I co-founded Fix Forsyth Traffic. I'm up off of Post Road. I've been here in Forsyth, I don't know, probably going on about 7 years. And, you know, we moved up here in this area basically to get out of kind of the Atlanta traffic and all the mess that is, the, you know, Atlanta. It's a great place to go visit. I don't necessarily want to live there. But I've just kind of recently found in the last few years, we started this organization because it took me 45 minutes to drive 8 miles one day to my office. And I thought that was a little absurd. It just felt like I was right back down in Atlanta. So what's the deal? So as we started handing out cards and sort of putting this together, we ended up finding out that we're not alone. There's a lot of other folks that feel that way, including organizations that have already come together, homeowner organizations, many of which you've heard of this evening. And so we kind of, along with our own efforts, put everybody together and are trying to be an advocate for all of you, in a sense, that don't necessarily have a voice on the commission and whatnot. So at any rate, one of the things that I think is a cardinal sin for any elected official is disenfranchising citizens. For those, you know, that know, we've already talked about it. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here because we've heard from a lot of good speakers here this evening about this. But make no mistake that we are here. I don't know if you've been convinced of that this evening or already know it. But like everybody said, is when I have four elected officials that I have no say in voting for, but they have plenty of say in what goes on in my backyard, that is the definition of being disenfranchised. I can't vote for them, vote in or vote them out. So anyway, on that very point, I applaud Mike and the other state representatives here and other elected officials that are open-minded about revisiting this concept, the thing that we lost in 2009, to get things right again. We need to make things right. You just can't, that's not democracy when, you know, you can't vote for people that affect your life, your local leaders. So anyway, in terms of what is best, is countywide voting the best? I don't know. I know it's a whole lot better here because everybody's vote counts. Right now, everybody's vote does not count, and that is not good. So I'm open to alternatives. If there's a better solution, that's great. But as a default, we should at least get back to considering countywide, unless, again, there is something better than countywide. So I love that Mike is looking at different options and other representatives here. So I applaud those efforts. I'm so excited to see all these people out here in doing the other town halls around the county because we finally have some input. This is great because we kind of not had input lately. So that's kind of it. I want to be brief, not echo everybody else's, most everybody else's comments. The only thing I would like to say is Kristen is right. We do have a lot of other taxes coming. So I don't know if Sharon Spring Alliance is the best solution. You know, to be honest, I don't think they think it's the best solution. I think they're looking to see if it is. They're not convinced and trying to shove Sharon Springs down anybody's throat. They actually just want to do a study. And I think that's pretty noble to just get a study going and find out. So at any rate, one of the solutions will be better than what we have now, whether it's countywide governance or Sharon Springs or something in there. So anyway, thank you for your time and thanks for coming out tonight.
Thank you, Matt. So next is going to be Bob Rorke, and then our last speaker is Paul Silver, and then I'm going to attempt to moderate a little bit of a discussion. This will be a lot of fun. Bob?
Good evening. Thank you. Bob Rorke, I've lived in Georgia 19 years with 9 years here in Forsyth County. Just a quick show of hands, has anyone heard of the Forsyth County Comprehensive Plan? Ring a bell? Okay, maybe about 20%, roughly, just guessing. Well, 2 years ago, which the way we're growing here, that's kind of ancient history. But I want to bring up a little ancient history from 2 years ago and read you a resolution that was passed by the Board of Commissioners, and I believe the policy they established with the resolution was passed 5-0, if I'm doing my homework right. Number one of that resolution was, we will continue to ensure that new and existing development is supported adequately by necessary infrastructure, particularly roads, schools, public safety protection, and wastewater treatment systems. Number two, we will ensure that the new development does not cause a decline in existing levels of service for the community's residents and employers. Number three, we will support the local school board and encourage school location decisions that sustain the community's overall growth and development plans. And number four, the Forsyth County Board of Education will continue to provide quality education programs and facilities for the citizens of the county. So that was the 4 points of that resolution. And all I can say is, I believe in that, but I don't believe it's occurring today. So if we want to continue on the path that's occurring, we just don't do anything, or we try to look at something and do something different so we can bring back ancient history from 2 years ago. Thanks.
Paul is one of my favorite constituents. He's been down to the Capitol several times. This theme of this meeting was on governance issues, but I did open up another topic, and Paul's got another topic that's near and dear to his heart, and we want to hear from him today. So, Paul?
I'm a self-advocate for autism because I have Asperger's, and there's a bill we're trying to reintroduce into the state capitol called Ava's Law, with many insurance companies can deny families insurance coverage for their children for autism, which is an outrage to me. So I emailed Mike Duncan. Okay. So I said, I'm coming to the Capitol and I'd like to talk to you about Ava's Law. So we talked, and it didn't get passed this year. It didn't go through the House. It went through the Senate. There is an event at Lanier Tech. I just had to pull out my phone to see what when it's October 25th from 1 to 5 at Lanier Tech. We will have Shelley Hendricks, who's from Autism Speaks, who's going to talk about the grassroots effort in Georgia and across this country. But you have to RSVP to attend. The event's free, but it's you have the RSVP on tacnow.org/Georgia. And I'll be more than happy to email you the information so you can email it to everybody else. Okay, I will.
Well, I neglected at the beginning, we do have some other elected officials here. I'm going to name them and just thank them for being here. I know we have my colleague, Representative Geoff Duncan. We have Senator-elect Michael Williams. I saw County Commissioner Jim Boff. I saw County Commissioner Cindy Mills. I saw former County Commissioner Jim Harrell, former County Commissioner Patrick Bell. I've seen School Board Member Kristen Morrissey, School Board Member Ann Crow. There may be others. If so, I apologize for missing you. What's that? And Commissioner Todd Levan, of course, he was here before all of us, so how can I miss Todd? So what's that? And Darla's here as well, from chair of our school board. I really appreciate those people being here and listening with me at this town hall. So I wanna make a couple comments first, and then I wanna open the floor for questions. And what I would like at this time is, Carter, is everybody voted in this poll who wants to vote? If so, in just a minute, we'll put up another question and we'll do that one. But if you presented today and wouldn't mind answering a question while I'm talking, if you come quietly down and sit up front, because then I want to be able to present you to answer questions. Either you're a pro or con speaker and you're willing to answer a question and you've already spoken today, go on and sort of quietly come up front so we can get some questions. But I want to tell a little bit about my position about this, because a lot of people ask me, and I wrote a lot of the editorial. First, on the city of Sharon Springs, the only city that I would support is what is we call in the state government a city light. Cities have to have three services, things like fire, police, parks. I'm not supporting our city doing any of those things. The county does a good job of those things. We'll be looking at something more like what Peachtree Corners did right down 141. Services they provide are code enforcement, zoning, and sanitation. They don't do police, don't do fire, don't do the big money things. The City of Peachtree Quarters was formed, I think, 4 years ago. Representative Tom Rice, colleague of mine from down in Peachtree Quarters. And they had a $1 million property tax their first year, and they've had zero ever since, because what they're doing really doesn't cost a lot of money. So just so you know, my personal position is that I would not support a city that did the big services that we're already doing a good job in the county. I would only support a service city with the lighter services with a much smaller footprint. So that's an important distinction that I wanted to get on the record, and I did say that in my editorial. Secondly, when it comes to the county commission and city council, city consolidation, I'm open to those. I ran for the school board in 2006 countywide, and poor little guy from this corner, a lot of people knew me down here, but when I went up to Jot 'em Down Road, nobody knew me up there. There is an interesting trade-off between how big is your district. If I'm running and I have 200,000 people vote for me, what if you had a 1 million person county? Should you still be countywide? I think there's an interesting trade-off there between countywide and district, and I sort of am open to both ideas. I think if you look at the other counties who are like our size, they have a mix. So that may be a good answer. City-county consolidation, I think, is another thing interesting to look at. A lot of people say, well, why do you need a city? Well, if you look at Hall County, they have a bunch of cities. Gwinnett County has a bunch of cities. Cobb County, well, should we get rid of all of them? I mean, there's the reason you have cities is because some decisions you want to be very local. If you look at, part of my district is Johns Creek. They have six city council people, and they're all elected citywide in Johns Creek. But those people are very local to Johns Creek. They know the community more and more. So as you get bigger and bigger, I think there's something to be said for having people who are closer and understand the area very intimately, because when you're making zoning, that's the most intimate decision you can make. That all being said, I have not made up my mind on anything other than it's all very important to talk about. That's why I want to get everybody together again. We'll take some polling. So Carter, why don't you bring up the next poll, and I'm going to open for questions for 15 minutes. The next question is, if the Wi-Fi cooperates, is this the one on Sharon Springs? The next question is going to be, do you think we should do a feasibility study for the city of Sharon Springs? So that's your question. Yes, maybe, no. This is not whether you support the city itself, but you support a feasibility study for the city of Sharon Springs. At this time, I actually had a couple people email me and say, can we ask questions of the experts? So this is the time I'm going to open the floor, and you can ask a question from where you're sitting, and I'll repeat it, and then hopefully we get some experts who'll be willing to answer a question. So questions from the floor. Ma'am, right here, yes. Right here in the pink, yeah, yes. Oh, no, ma'am, sorry. Stand up, so.
I knew you way back when there were kids in school.
That's right.
Yeah. I don't know.
Landon, right?
Yes.
Very good.
Second year sophomore at
Reinhardt. Yes, great.
Yeah. And I'm sorry, I forgot your kid's name.
Brandon.
Brandon. Yeah, they've always misidentified by teachers. My question is, I've been here 20 years, and chosen, well, raising our children in L.A., where I grew up, to the South Portion. It's basically, we could step over the line to the best hospitals, and we found our doctors in the street, like, but I'd love the progress that we have. But I'm very visual. I love the visual, rural setting that we have. I think a lot of that goes back to being able to vote with the commissioners countywide. I don't know your job, your expertise, what you're doing. How do we get that? How do we get it on ballot again? Or do commissioners just arbitrarily decide to give up their...
No, that's a good question. So the question... from Robbie is, how do you change the commission format? The counties and the cities are creations of the General Assembly of Georgia, the legislature. All of them were created by the legislature, and they can all be changed by the legislature. So there's a process called local legislation, which would mean when Macon and Bibb County decided to consolidate 2 years ago, they had a bill, which is a law. It was gone through both House and Senate, passed by the governor. But it's a separate process called local legislation. And what that means, if the local legislators agree on the bill, then the other legislators, as a matter of courtesy, will vote that through by essentially by a unanimous consent type procedure. That way, I'm not trying to tell the city of Rome what they're doing, and the people in Valdosta are not trying to tell me in Forsyth County what to do. So it boils down to, if your local delegation, which are the locally elected state house members, which there are five, and there are two senators. So if that group of people agrees on the bill and puts it in the local calendar, then we can change the charter of the county of Forsyth County. That's exactly what happened in 2009. As I think somebody, Kristen, mentioned, there was a ballot question about whether we should do this or not. That got a very high response rate of yes. There's debate about whether that question was worded fairly or not, but regardless, that was a non-binding straw poll. It had no binding effect whatsoever. Then at that time, the delegation members, the members of the House and Senate from Forsyth County, introduced a bill in the Georgia legislature which changed it from countywide to district for both the Board of Ed and the county. So if we were to do anything different, if we were to do more commissioners or some countywide or all countywide or a city of, the county commission change is 100% a function of the legislature. To form a city, there's a million steps, but the last step, you do have to get it through the legislature, but then the last step is a vote of the people. By the Georgia Constitution, you cannot form a new city unless everybody goes to the poll and votes yes. But that's a little bit different process. But for the county commission, it would be up to the five people in the House and the two people in the Senate to introduce a bill to do that. Other questions? Commissioner Boff.
Yes, can you describe at all the steps to unify government?
Steps to unify government. That is also a joint function of the legislature and the voters. Essentially, again, you have to have the local legislation, but then you have to have two separate votes. The city has to vote yes, the county has to vote yes. So you have to have two separate votes. Question, Ms. Ward.
When you say we to do the answer to this, we, who is we?
Who's going to do the, you want to talk about how the, who's going to do the feasibility study, Stephen?
Who's going to fund that?
Yeah, that's a great question.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. So the feasibility study, as a nonprofit organization, which is what the Sharon Springs Alliance is, right? So we're a 501c3. That means we're allowed to collect donations from residents, from businesses of the area, in order to raise the money to pay for the feasibility study. The feasibility study is run by the Carl Vinson Institute at the University of Georgia, and it's roughly around $30,000. So starting in kind of mid-summer, we've actually started our efforts to raise money for that feasibility study. We're about two-thirds of the way there. Over 100 and close to 150 residents have donated to that. And so the intent and the goal in order to run this is we've got to raise the remaining amount of money for that feasibility study. At that point, once we have that once we have the funds, right, we will enlist with the Carl Vinson Institute to run that study. That has to be sponsored by a state representative, but at that point you can run that feasibility study to get the feedback of how fiscal, what are the financial implications of a city, how would those services be run, how would they be paid for, and the cost structure of that, how would the city be structured, et cetera. But any other questions on that? And if anybody has any specific questions afterwards, many of the SSA members are gonna be in the back and we're happy to have one-on-one conversations with you as well.
Excellent. Yes, sir, in the middle, in the blue pillow.
I just have a question on the city. How long will it take to create once the feasibility study happens? And then, will it be too late, though? With the way progress is happening so far, and the land that you see going up for sale is already up for sale, if it's sold and it's zoned already for development, what can the city do when there's really no land left?
Do you want to answer that for me? Yeah. I will tell you that the process in the legislature generally is there's a feasibility study, then there's a bill. The bill sits in the legislature for a year to study over, nine times out of 10, and then it would pass the legislature, and then you would have a vote. So assuming everything went perfectly, the earliest you could have a vote would probably be November of 2016, in which case you wouldn't have a new city till 2017. And of course, it could take a little bit longer, but that's kind of your fastest timetable if the things went right. As far as the question about zonings, this happened in Johns Creek. The new city cannot pull under the rug of a developer on existing zoning that was done by the earlier authority. So this happened in Johns Creek and Fulton. If Fulton had already zoned something, then there's rules about how you need to change that. You want to add anything to that, Steve?
Absolutely. So My response to that, other than the process is exactly right. Of course he knows the process. But to take an approach that isn't it too late is just a defeatist type of approach, right? At this point, yes, a lot of the area has been zoned a certain way. That doesn't mean it's been developed a certain way. And frankly, as you've seen, zonings change. They can apply for different zoning, right? But we also, if you go down and talk to folks from Johns Creek, yes, a lot of that area was already zoned. But what they started finding is every little parcel, every small parcel of land was suddenly trying to get, you know, townhomes put in that tiny little parcel and squeeze everything into every little last corner, a little scratch, right? There's still a lot of land here. Go look at Google Aerial Maps. There's a lot of land that's not developed, right? The goal here is if you can create a city, then that city can create an acceptable use, a land use plan, a comprehensive land use plan, new zoning, create a brand new set of mechanisms for different type of development, encourage commercial growth, and that's the hope and that's the options that you look at that time.
Is the study just about the feasibility of Sharon Springs, or is it going to include the option of the city and the county merging?
Sure, I'll answer that as well. The study that we're working to commission is to examine whether or not cityhood makes sense for South Forsyth. So it's specifically tied to the city. It's designed around three services, right? Zoning and planning, code enforcement, and then it would be solid waste, right? To Mike's point, it's called a limited services city. That means that those are the services that city has and is responsible for. The remaining parts of the services would be still responsible by the county.
Excellent. Has everybody voted on this poll? If so, look at it real quickly because I'm about to do my final question as we start to wrap up. Okay, go ahead, Carter, to the final question, the last question of the evening, which is, I wrote it so I should remember what it was. It's about the county commission. What changes do you support for the county commission, if any? So this one's a little bit, the answers are gonna be a little bit more wordy, I believe. So what changes do you support for the county commission, if any? Processing, please wait. There we go, that's better. So no change. All committees elected countywide, a mix, and city-county consolidation. I know it's not perfect, but whichever one there you would like. Other questions? Yes, Chris.
My question is kind of related to the consolidation idea.
Yeah.
I'm wondering about the budgetary impact of that. Can we get a sense of what a budget, say the county spends per person in services versus what a city would, like the example of city council?
All right, one of my speakers is coming up to answer. I don't know. The question was, what's the sort of rough idea of budget of cost per person for the city and the county?
The city of Cumming spends approximately $4,500 to $5,000 per person. Forsyth County spends roughly, and this is the budget divided by your number of citizens, the Forsyth County spends roughly $450 to $500 per person, meaning the city of Cumming spends as much as many of your northeastern cities like Boston per person, which is a little bit absurd. If you look at that in an annual budgetized amount, if you did that for the city of Cumming, their annual budget would be over $800 million annually.
Thank you. Other questions? We'll get the guy in the tan first, but the lady behind in the white right here. Yes, yes, ma'am.
How do we put a moratorium on the building?
How to do a moratorium on the building? That is one question that I am not going to answer because it is purely a function of the county commission. You need to talk to your commissioner. Some of them are here. I will say, though, that legally, moratoriums are very tricky. There was one for a short period of time here in the late 2000s. It's not as easy as you think, but it can be done in some circumstances. I'm not an expert on it, but it's the function of the county commission as a state legislature. That's one I can say I have nothing to do with that one. My man in the tan here, San Diego shirt. Yes.
How would you go about and consolidate a city and a county together?
Okay, what normally happens is that essentially you take two governments and make one and you make a bigger elected council. So you still usually have a mayor. There's still a mayor of Macon, there's still a mayor of Athens Clark County, but you take what used to be the city council and what used to be the county commission and you make one board that governs both of them.
You still get to have the mayor who does all the ceremonial and does all the sort of city promotion type things, but then they take all their services and put them together so that there's only, like I said, there's only one police department, there's one water department, there's one things like that. Other questions, Brad, in the back, far back. Can you talk loud, Brad?
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
If we did go to a new city, what would be the process that they would go through if they wanted to expand services later? So in other words, by re-asking the question, you start out with city life, three services only. How easy would it be to change to city heavy sometimes in the future?
Well, that's again a function of the charter of the city, and if the local legislators at some point in the future decided that they wanted to pork up the city, then they could change the charter to do so. What's that? I feel bad. I should know that exact answer. And I know for certain the legislature could do it. There's home rule for cities, but I don't believe the cities can expand their major services without the legislature, but that is something actually is very important to me, so I will find out before this process goes further. Lady in the back, yes.
Hi, since we have some commissioners here, I was wondering if they could answer a question of why they aren't listening to citizens when we continually ask for them to stop the growth.
I understand that people are frustrated with that. I will let you ask that to a commissioner to hear if they want to talk to you or at one of their public comments areas. Yes. My man in the suit back here.
Yeah, I have a question. My name is Mark Morris. There's a lot of people here that were supporting the idea that we should have a countywide election.
Yes.
Okay, more representation. And 20% is not enough. Well, we elect 535 people to go to Washington, we only get three votes there, okay? So here's my question to the group, and I'd like someone to answer this. What part of the county should we strip from their local representation so that the southern part of the county have more representation? Because that's effectively what's gonna happen. And there's a lot of people that supported it, so I'd like to hear from someone that supported it to give that answer, if you would, please.
Anybody want to answer that? Yeah, Stephen, you want to give it a whirl?
So, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but the districts are not by just location, they're also by population, right? So it would not be that there are certain that some group of population, say 50,000 people, the other district's got 50,000 people, right? So it's still that each district and the commissioner from that district would still have the same population base that they're representing as their local. But at the same time, what you're creating is an opportunity for us all, if it were to go the way that it's countywide vote, is that you would then have the ability to, everybody has the ability to vote in countywide, right? So it's the entire population that gets the vote, so I don't see how it'd be the wrong way.
Yeah, that's my thought. I mean, there's a thought that it's certain areas versus certain areas. It's still one person, one vote. So again, if you have 50,000 people in the north and 50,000 people in the central, 50,000 people in the south, each of them has the same influence on a countywide election. And I say governments have mixes of that. We have the House elected by district, and then the whole state gets their senator. So there's a lot of examples where you have a mix of those kind of those governmental models. Because I think it can be both. Jack, yeah? All right, real quick, Jack, because I want any more questions? I want to see hands if there's any more questions first. All right, so we'll have one more question from the man in the red here after Jack speaks briefly.
One thing, regardless of if the city and the county merged or if we maintained the five districts that we have, I really believe that a balanced solution would be to add two commissioners and make it a seven-seat commission, and those two commissioners would be elected at large. So then we'd have your particular district and three people who are technically neutral, and so that's not necessarily a majority. There'd never be an overwhelming majority, but there would definitely be much more balance in the commission.
Thank you. The gentleman in the red gets to finish us off.
I'd like to go back to the previous question that was asked over here.
Okay.
That requested one of the commissioners to respond as to why they weren't listening to us. And we have a commissioner here who volunteered but didn't get...
Cindy, do you want to speak?
I will.
All right. You want to come up to the microphone?
I honestly believe that every commissioner, just because they don't vote the way you want them to vote, doesn't mean they're not listening. I personally tried to answer every email. I mean, please be respectful. I try to answer every email that people send to me, and it doesn't mean that I answer it always the way that it's wanted to be answered. We have things like, as Kristen pointed out, the land use map. We have things that, you know, with state laws, property rights. I mean, we try to make decisions based upon balance. I mean, we spent $30 million recently to improve sewer. We put $48 million into improving Mullinax Road and two sections of Old Atlanta. We put a transportation bond out that we hope people will support that will relieve some of the traffic congestion. We do listen. I mean, we're not able always to deny zonings, but we try. You know, there's lots of misinformation that gets put out. We get quoted as being high density commissioners when really over the last year our densities have dropped, and now we barely ever do any variances anymore. And our density is down to under two now, 1.9 units per acre. In a county that zones up to six in your UDC, in your residential, to be down below two, it's not fair to say we're high density commissioners. I think that we do listen. We are trying to do things. We just approved going to certain districts of doing, it's gotta go through the UDC and public hearing, of only having two zonings per month in specific districts. So to say that we are doing things, that we do listen, it's very frustrating because you see development that somebody wisely pointed out that was approved in the mid-2000s. And we can't control that. There's a Walmart coming up in my district that was approved in the mid-2000s that they probably won't even have to come before us for a permit. You know, so we have to work within the confines of the law. I do think it's worthy to note, and I've been trying to do my own homework on this issue, that, and I tried to get help from our secretary, of the 20 counties that are in the metro, that have populations. If you look on ACCG, the 20 most populated counties, Forsyth County is tops in the good things, and we're tops, I mean, we're at the bottom of the bad things, and meaning that if you look at the 20 most populated counties in the state, we're number 11, we're right in the midst of it. We have the highest SAT scores, we have the highest graduation rate, and that's in schools that, granted, some might be overcrowded now, but they have still provided the quality of education, and it's why a lot of them want to move here. We are providing the lowest crime rate. We have the lowest millage rate of all the top 20 counties. And that's why a lot of people wanted to move here. You know why we have the lowest millage rate? Because we've had a steady, balanced growth. It might seem like it's not balanced at this moment, but we need some growth to be able to keep the millage rate low so your taxes are low. It's all about balance, and we are cognizant of that. And we try, we're on the hot seat, which is we ran for the office, and we get the big bucks for being it. But at the same time, it's not that we don't care or we aren't responsive to people. We really are trying. We just up Res 3. The only reason we lowered Res 3 was because all these zonings, when the market came back, all these zonings came in at Res 4. So we changed Res 3 to make it more. We'd rather have Res 3 than Res 4, and it worked. All the zonings changed to Res 3. Well, then we kept dropping density down on Res 3 and got it to really around 2, which you think would be a Res 2, but it's a Res 3. It's a little confusing. And so we are trying to constantly, we just upped at the last board meeting the Res 3 category. We upped it back to 14,750, and we're hopeful that it won't drive people back to Res 4. We're worried about it. I'm worried about it. But we are trying to do things that are responsive to people, and we're trying to do things to make it be better.
Thank you, Cindy. I have two things to say, and I'll close this out. For those who have not been an elected official, and there are some current and former ones in the room, Cindy and I are friends. We have lunch from time to time. Whether you like or don't like a decision, these people, they're doing an extraordinarily difficult job. And I do believe that the vast majority of people are doing it for what they think are the right reasons. And I think
I would just ask that always in your discourse that you look at them as the real people. They're trying to do a very difficult job, and unless you've been elected, it's very hard to understand how tough their job is, and I really appreciate Cindy making her points today. So the last thing is tell you kind of one thought and tell you where we're going to go from here. You know, I also know that we are the top right now, and everyone wants to move here, but I've lived in the metro area since the early 80s, and past performance of your investment is not a guarantee of future success. And so if you look at DeKalb County in the 70s was the place to be, and then Gwinnett in the 80s was the place to be, and then Cobb. It doesn't, because you're the place to be right now, doesn't mean you're the place to be next. And so even though we're doing great right now, my passion is to make sure that we're doing the right things to stay as well as we are today. So where are we going from here? I know a couple of my colleagues, and Representative Duncan and Senator-elect Williams, or almost Senator-elect, I guess in 3 weeks that'll be official, are going to be having meetings on similar topics in the next couple weeks or months or so. Maybe some others coming out. I encourage you to participate in those. I'm open to listening. I'll be here as late as anybody wants to talk to me. We'll have more thoughts. And then I personally plan on commissioning actually an official poll where we actually go to the constituents and find out more than just unscientific what they think. And I'm really got my heart into researching all these ideas. Again, thank you for being here. I appreciate your support, and thanks again.
Stephen and Newman, N-E-W-M-A-N. And I can get you an email.